Are you dinging?
One, two, three. Okay,
say one, two, three.
Two, three.
This is Jefferson Starship.
And you're watching Coachella Valley Music Show.
Music show. We're coming to you from Fantasy Springs Resort and Casino. Today I have Rick Clark, singer, songwriter, guitar player,
right.
World traveler.
Well.
Well, you just finished doing some country music.
Yes, I was recording with a band up in Modesto. The name doesn't fit the band because they're strictly country western.
Okay.
And the name is Pat Coleman and the Angels of Death.
Oh, it doesn't sound like country at all.
It doesn't at all. But they're really good. They have Commander Cody's pedal steel player.
Nice.
Bunch of really good people in the band. So. Uh-huh. And they want to do a couple of my songs on their next CD release. So I'm looking forward to working with them.
What songs
and
do they want to do yours?
Well, I think they want to do So Cold and My Poor Heart.
So now you're living in Idlewild.
Yeah. Well, actually Pine Cove, which is a little bit east of Idlewild. Thank you, David. And it's beautiful up there. Can't complain about it. We got snowed in January, but we did okay. We just stayed, huddled up in the cabin with our two dogs.
You have a lot of great musicians up there.
Oh, yeah, very good.
Yeah. They're just settled up there.
Uh-huh.
And, any place you walk in, you're bound to see a good player.
Mm-hmm. Exactly. And Jamie, my girlfriend and I, we went to see Willie B last night at the Idlewild, the wine bar place up in Idlewild. And also John King was playing with him. And they're both brilliant musicians. I'm really lucky to be around an area where, you can kind of pick and choose. You can say, well, I want a guy that's a great violinist, or a fiddle player.
Yep.
And that's John King. I want a guy that's a great singer-songwriter. Well, John King is a good songwriter, too. But Willie B, brilliant guitar player and a really great songwriter. So I'm very lucky. I feel privileged to be up there. And I'm so glad that we reacquainted, you and me, because I knew you back in the early 80s. But I'm so glad to see you and be here with you. It's really a treat.
Well, I think it must have been your birthday, and that's why I even knew you were in the room. I had gone up to Idlewild to to celebrate St. Patty's Day
in a sane
environment.
Exactly.
And the next day I thought I'd hit a couple of music spots, and the people on the stage said, I'd like to dedicate this song to a friend of mine. It's his birthday, and his brother wrote the song. This is a Gene Clark song. Because we wouldn't have recognized each other after all these years.
I know. Well, I mean, 81 or so.
So I walked over and I said, I knew your brother. And you said, hell, I knew you.
Yeah. And, I mean, here I am now with you.
Yeah.
Which, it's such a privilege for me to be asked to come down here and be on the show. Because I didn't even actually expect to see you, but now I've seen you again.
Well,
and you and I are rekindling a friendship.
It's a simple twist of fate.
Right.
When did you start playing guitar?
About 12.
Okay.
And I didn't really get serious about it until maybe 14. And then my dad was a great guitar player. But he raised 13 kids. So,
wow.
Yeah. I mean, a musical career was not in it for him.
Yeah.
But a lot of people remember it. I mean, my dad could play a song, and he would play rhythm and lead at the same time. And I never have been able to figure out how he did that. But, he used to put the guitar and the mandolin on the bed and say, you kids, keep your hands off of those. Of course, yeah. But what he really meant was, if you want to pick it up and learn how to do it, okay, I won't say anything. But, Gene was the first. He picked up the guitar and started, playing and writing. And by the time I was in high school, he was already a major international star.
So everything turn, turn, turn. There is a season turn, turn, turn.
The Byrds are here.
And you better start swimming or you'll sink like a stone. For the times, they are a-changing.
So I went, well, if you can do it, I can do it.
What's your favorite show that you ever did?
My favorite show that I ever did? Probably, one of my brother's tribute shows. I've done so many of them, And they're actually doing one in Australia fairly soon.
All right.
They have Gene Clark tributes all over the world now.
Wow.
Of course, I can't get to Australia for that one, but, I still do them around the country quite a bit.
Do you do Cry in Your Beer songs?
Do you do some of your songs?
Yeah. Do you do some of Gene's songs?
Yeah, I do Gene. I do other people. I've just been learning some Merle Haggard because, he just passed away.
Yeah.
And he was like a, country western royalty. So,
yep.
I was raised on country music. And, Gene got lucky, and a lot of people say that he is the actual creator of folk rock. The Byrds and all
that. Well, he wrote a lot of the songs for the Byrds. I'm not sure if he got all the credit.
Well, he did. There was really something weird that happened at the beginning when they all formed the group. They got signed to Columbia and Tickner and Dixon Management. And after Mr. Tambourine Man came out, Gene wrote The Flip Side, which is Feel a Whole Lot Better. And suddenly he was like swimming in cash, And, right before that, not too long before that, he had been in the New Christy Minstrels. You remember them?
Yeah.
Yeah. And so he was making tons of money. He was swimming in cash. And, the other Byrds were going, how come Gene's getting paid so much? And we're only just making it by. And Eddie Tickner said, because he writes the songs, you know. And it's kind of weird for him because after that, I'm not going to mention names, but some of the people were not happy with the situation. And they kind of spent their energy on being confrontational rather than working together.
Well, I know that back in those days that Roger McGuinn was doing pretty well because I ended up living in his house because my father married his wife.
Right, right.
Linda, who said to say hello, by the way.
Okay,
yeah. Yeah, you know, she was had to be one of the most beautiful women in town.
Yeah.
And she gave me my baby sister, actually. Who rides in Cavalia. But, so I know Roger McGuinn did well with the Byrds.
Right.
And we did like those songs. But I'm more interested in the songs that you've been doing.
Well, I've been writing a whole lot in the country western vein. I've written stuff that fits in other, you know, genres and stuff. But right now I'm pretty much concentrating on traditional country western, which is not to say, you know, Nashville. They don't do country western anymore. They do cookie cutter. That's all they do, you know.
No, the sound of country and even country rock is fading, so I'm really glad you're doing that.
Well,
you know,
it has to be done.
Yeah.
At least it has to be. Because it would disappear.
Now, I wanted to get into country.
Mm-hmm.
And people said, you know, you're not country enough. Nashville's real strict. And, you know, you're more California country, and they don't take kindly to that.
Mm-hmm.
And this country rock stuff isn't even all that their bag there. And now I see the wisdom because it's starting to get very poppy and you can't even tell you're listening to in rappy and I don't want to stop the train from something growing, but you don't want to lose the roots and the seeds. You don't breed them out completely.
Right.
So I'm glad you're keeping it going.
Well, you know, it's kind of like I guess it's my, you know, my purpose is to keep that kind of alive. There's still a lot of really good country western players, but real country western doesn't get recognized near as much as, okay, Taylor Swift. She came out as a country artist. And if you look at her now, she's now pop. You know, there's a whole lot of people that came out to be Nashville country music people, and they ended up being pushed into pop, and now they don't have any country roots at all. So I'm trying to keep it alive. You're right.
Now, did you have country roots? You know, I mean, did you have a shotgun and a pickup truck?
Yeah, I did.
Gather wood and chop wood and all that?
Yeah, we still do that. Okay. Jamie and I, we burn wood, you know. Okay. We have propane, but it's like astronomical to be able to afford. And I don't mind stoking a fire. Kind of gives you that kind of comfortable, homey feeling.
Right.
So I'm glad to be able to do it, actually.
I'd like to see you on Farm Aid.
I would,
you know,
too.
You're a grassroots guy.
Yeah, yeah.
You know?
I'd love to do that, you know. But, you know, I've met a guy that wrote some songs for Willie and for Waylon Jennings and for Merle Haggard. His name's Freddie Powers.
All right.
And he's a really great songwriter. And I met him back in the 80s. And I happened to be with Gene at the time. And they went and took off and went up to Reno to see Willie play. I don't know what happened with that situation because after that, there was no furthering of Gene Clark and Merle Haggard or Willie Nelson or anything like that. I just chalk it up to twist of fate, maybe. It didn't happen.
What about that Willie Nelson 4th of July Picnic Festival? I went to it one year, many years ago.
Wow.
My dad played at it.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
But is that still going on?
As far as I know, it is.
That might be a fun ride.
Oh, it would be wonderful. If I were asked to go there and play, I would be honored. It would just be, to me, validation. And they still keep all that country alive. The best country town I've been in was Austin, Texas. Have you spent any time there?
No, I haven't.
No. Oh, you can walk down the street, and there are so many clubs there, and every time you walk by one of them, there are people playing country music. And it's like the best live music town. And in 2000, I did a Gene Clark tribute at the Continental Club in Austin, Texas. And I met Freddie Kurt, who's the president of the Musicians Union down there. And he's also a really great drummer, really good guitar player, and a songwriter. So he's kind of, you know, and I got to meet and hang out with a lot of people who are like the movers and shakers of Austin, Texas.
Right.
Have you ever seen Austin City Limits?
Well, you know, when I went down to Texas, I was very young.
Mm-hmm.
And we had, and Texans don't like it when I say this, but we went to a place called Nowhere, Texas. That does exist. There is a place called Nowhere, Texas, and
wow.
That's where they threw the festival that year.
Mm-hmm.
And it was a wild year for a festival.
Wow.
You know, but it was an awful lot of fun. Adult country I found here is there's a club, Jackalope does country.
Jackalope.
Here. Yeah.
Oh. Okay.
Yeah, and they have a country night at Fantasy. We've got one night where they have country here. I think I should just have you play me a little bit though, because it's so hard to find any real country these days.
Okay, I'd be glad to.
All right.
I'll go get my act.
Okay.
I'm gonna play you a song,
okay,
which is "Crying in Your Beer," country western.
All right.
And I'd also like to mention that one of the royalty of country western music just passed away, Mr. Merle Haggard. And I've been doing some of his songs too. But right now I'm going to play you one of my own "Crying in a Beer" song.
Good.
This is called "Another Man."
Care a lot for me, that he may feel one.
I'm feeling. Though I hurt them as well as I can.
Stopping in and playing at places up there
Idlewild? Yeah, I play at Aromas, and I'm going to be playing at Uncle B's, which is a new restaurant, a barbecue joint up there.
Okay.
And I'm still working with the guys in Modesto, and I've got a bunch of songs, and I'm going to do a new CD. And,
right on.
And hopefully, you know, we'll be able to stay in touch, because I can't believe you guys came up there, and it's been so long since you knew me and I knew you. And to me, it seems like kismet. Is that the right word?
Yes.
Okay. Yeah, it's kind of like kismet, you know. And Jamie, she teaches me a whole lot of, you know, Jewish phrases. So, you know, I don't seem like a terrible Gentile. It's such a pleasure.
I grew up with, around a lot of Jewish phrases myself. My mother and my father both have surrounded themselves with that. And now I found my own that calls me a shitska.
Yeah, I don't want to try to pronounce it because I'll come out with the wrong word.
Shitska. Goya.
Shiksa.
It's shitska.
Yeah. Goyim. Yeah. Gentiles.
I'm not so Gentile, though.
Well.
What do you remember?
What do I remember?
Yeah, since you haven't seen me.
Oh, my God. I remember being at the Natural Fudge. There were several acts.
That was my first show.
Yeah, really?
Ever in my life.
Really?
With a band.
You were great.
With a band, yeah.
You were great. And you know Jody Romero, don't you?
Yeah.
Well, she played there as well, you know. And her mother, Rita, was a really close friend of Jean.
I loved Rita.
Yeah, well, I haven't seen them again for a long period of time. I think the last time I saw Rita was when Jean was living in Sherman Oaks, and she came over and hung out with us and had dinner with us and stuff. Yeah. And I knew Jody from the Natural Fudge.
Right.
And, you know, it was all about the same time as...
My dad came to see me play there, but you guys didn't run into each other then.
No, I met your dad after Gene's death, and at the Pierce Brothers funeral home down in the valley. And he was crying, tears streaming down his face. And, you know, we all went outside because we were all crying and stuff, and... you know, we hung out there for about, I don't know, 45 minutes or so. And I remember your dad's car. It was a Cadillac, and it said, I Kung Fu, on the license plate.
That's that white convertible Cadillac.
Yes, exactly. Yeah, that's the one. Yeah. God, boy, so much water under the bridge. And here we are, reacquainting, and I can't be happier. It's pretty cool.
The Natural Fudge, I think I was 18 or 19.
Probably.
So I was real young.
Yeah, I was in my 20s, you know, maybe early 30s, but no more than that. Yeah. So, you know, I loved listening to you. You know,
even back then?
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Hey, you know, we were all, you know, a lot younger than we are now.
Yeah.
You know, so, but I don't mean, I'm sorry. I don't mean to age you or me, but, you know, I can feel the aches in my bones nowadays, but I just keep putting my head down and, you know, trying to power through it all and come out on the other side better off than I was before I started.
Yeah.
So it's kismet.
Well, it's a lot of fun, you know, running into people that you know or met.
Incredible.
You know, family ties and,
and
music, you know, it makes the whole journey warm.
Oh, yeah.
and
festive. Well, you know, since I've reacquainted with you and David, who I had never met before, you guys are, like, really cool. It's wonderful to know that someone who I knew way back, you know, is, you know, here now. So I have people that I can connect with.
Yeah, yeah, because we're kind of fleeing from Los Angeles.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, we're all refugees from L.A. Exactly.
So we're going to go your Facebook to Rick Clark if you want to see what you're up to.
Okay,
you posted your next show.
Right, yeah, Jamie, honey.
Next concert.
Yeah. What's my Facebook?
No, it's Facebook.
It's just on Facebook. Yep. But anyway, I'll give you my email address as well so we can all stay in touch. This is wonderful. I've had such a lot of fun being here. And I thank you, and I thank David very much.
I'm so glad I got to hear some country music.
Yeah, thank you, sweetie. It's a pleasure. Yeah. So, anything else?
I think we're good.
We're good?
I think we're good.
We're good, okay. Thank you, Doreen. Okay, it's so nice to see you again.